Welcome to Hindu Analysis, August 14, 2018. So today we are going to see all these articles. So the first article is Pune tops ease of living index. So this ease of living index is released by Ministry of Housing and Urban Affairs. So this is the first of its kind survey. In this survey, it listed the top performing cities in our country and the bottom or poor performing cities in our country. So according to the survey, Pune, Navi Mumbai and Greater Mumbai, they are the top cities in this ease of living index, and Rampur, Kohima, Patna are the poor performing cities in our country according to this ease of living index. So on what basis this Ministry of Housing and Urban Affairs is calculating this ease of living index? In the sense, the ability to provide the data, that is the corporations in those cities, if they provide data, they included it in the calculation and make the final decision according to the data. And these are the four major parameters on which it calculate this ease of living index. So this governance, in the sense the power supply, the water supply, the security, safety, air pollution, everything is included in this aspect. Similarly, the social indicators, economic indicators and the physical infrastructure which is available in those cities are all taken into calculation while calculating this index. So if you see in this pic, Greater Mumbai, Pune, Tirupati, these all cities tops the ease of living index. Similarly, Chennai, Hyderabad, Ahmedabad is moderately scored in this ease of living index. Bengaluru, New Delhi are all scoring very poorly in this ease of living index. So if you see here, for example, Chennai scores like 14th rank in this ease of living index and Delhi is in 65th rank. So this is, if you see in case of Delhi, its scores is like zero in terms of housing and mixed land usage and 0.12 in case of economic and employment opportunities. So which means that the data which is provided by Delhi for this ease of index living calculation is insufficient. So if data is not available, they are not going to include those in the calculation. Obviously, it is going to affect their score. So it doesn't mean that it actually performs worst. It means that the data is insufficient. So this is like more towards like a data driven approach. If a city is unable to provide the data sufficiently, then how could be it able to manage its resources and how could be it able to plan for its future? So this is what the major question in front of every cities which are poorly performing in this ease of living index. So we have to focus more on the data driven approach for the urban planning as well as for the management of the cities. So the second article is coral reefs could survive global warming. So the global warming is increasing day by day. So this raises a lot of concern among all over the world. But researchers have recently suggested that there is nothing to worry about this global warming and all, because the marine reefs have the ability to survive this modern day global warming. This is what the researchers suggested recently. So how it is going to survive, in the sense, corals and algal partnership, by means of this partnership between corals and the algal, they are going to survive. How? In the sense, corals are the living organisms which is made up of substances called polyps. So they are living organisms, corals are. Similarly, algal, which is an example, is a zooxanthellae. So this is an algae which is live inside the coral. So this is coral. Inside the cells of the coral, this zooxanthellae algae is present. So this allows the sunlight to fall in the coral reefs and it helps to absorb the sunlight's energy, and which provides sufficiency for the coral reefs to grow. So in the sense, now the coral reef have the sufficient environment for the microorganisms to survive over this coral reefs also. Okay. So this is how this coral and the algae is in partnership, which in turn contribute towards each other. So if you see here in this picture, corals excrete their waste to tiny algae. So this algae which is present inside the coral, it again by means of photosynthesis process, it converts those waste into sugars, amino acids, lipids, which are useful for the corals to survive and to enhance. So this is a symbiotic relationship between coral and algae. So this is what helped the coral and algae to survive this modern day global warming. This is what the researchers suggested. So why they are saying like this, in the sense, the coral reefs have endured numerous climatic changes events which is taking place since the age of dinosaurs. So for a longer period of time, it is surviving for the change in the global warming. So similarly, this microalgae combination or symbionts have faced severe episodes roots of environmental change from the past, and it have managed to bounce back once if it gets depleted also. So this is what give such confidence to the researchers that the modern day global warming could also be sustained by this coral reefs. So this can increase in the abundance of the coral reef population. Similarly, the diversity of reef building coral reefs could also get increased, and it even make these coral reefs more resilient to the environmental changes. So this is what they suggested in this article. So the third article is Huff and EPUF on e-cigarette ban. So there is one public interest litigation in the Delhi High Court for which the Delhi government replied like it is going to ban the e-cigarettes. So if Delhi government is going to ban this e-cigarette, then it is going to join in the list of Karnataka and Maharashtra, which is already had banned this e-cigarettes. So what is this e-cigarette means? It is a device you see here, right? So it is an electronic device. It has a vaporizer, battery, cartridge, etc. So this vaporizer or the heater which is present inside the e-cigarette, which helps in turn convert the liquid solution, which is the nicotine and the flavors, into vapors or the aerosols. So this conversion of this liquid nicotine into aerosol is called as vaping. So this is how the e-cigarettes work. But what the concern here is, there is a lot of controversies which is going around this e-cigarettes. So as these e-cigarettes are new and rapidly evolving technologies, scientists are yet to uncover the ill effects of e-cigarettes. They have to study the health effects which could be caused by the e-cigarettes in the future. It is not yet completely analyzed. So similarly, if this e-cigarettes are going to be used at high temperature, then it could have the capacity to produce carcinogens, which are the cancer causing agents such as formaldehyde. So it is a major concern, right? Similarly, it could increase the odds of lung diseases as well as myocardial infarction. So these are all the possibilities that e-cigarettes could lead to. So the youths who are not even have the habit of smoking now turn their view towards this e-cigarette. So this is a major concern, right? Have the habit of smoking, but now this e-cigarettes induces them or tempted them to take this. So this is a major concern among the people. So which could also might lead to the habit of regular smoking in the future. So an alternative viewpoint to this controversy of e-cigarettes is that these e-cigarettes are more safer than the combustible cigarettes, which are normal cigarettes, because they are noxious. It is not that much noxious. It is safer. This is what the alternative thing is. But what should be the way forward here is this e-cigarette should be treated as a therapeutic alternative, which is only used for harm minimization in case of only the people who are having the habit of smoking could use this e-cigarette and get benefited out of this, not the one who are not at all having the smoking habit. So this one should be a therapeutic alternative, and the government should take some steps to regulate the e-cigarettes tightly, which it should also ban the usage of underage children, as well as it should not be available for the public use very freely, and it should set the standards for the aerosols amount which is present in the e-cigarettes. So these are all the way forward in order to control the e-cigarettes. So the next article is growth may pick up, but concerns remain. So this article is kind of like analysis of our Indian economy. So nearly more than one quarter of the year and 2 months of monsoon gets over. So how the remaining whole year is going to be like? So this is what we are going to see in this article. If you see the trends of our Indian economy, it is like this. So in terms of monsoon, the overall rainfall deficiency was like 3%. So even though it looks negligible, it is also a concern for us because we are a monsoon dependent country. But what the article suggests is it can pick up. That means the monsoon can pick up in the future. Similarly, if you see all the primary, secondary and the tertiary sector, the agriculture growth is like 3.4%, which is better, which is equivalent to last year. And similarly, the services sector is also performing better, and manufacturing sector also pick up in the growth rate. So these are all the indicators of how our economy is actually proceeding. If you see in case of index of industrial production, it is also showing that there is a substantial improvement in our industrial production all over the country. Automobiles and railway freights are also done well, and the problem which is due to the GST persisting in our country is also now overcame. So these are all indicates that we are proceeding in somewhat a good direction. So the another major indicator is strong pickup in GDP. So if we maintain the current growth rate of GDP, then we are certainly be above the 7%, which we actually aiming at. So if you see in this pick in 2016, the GDP is like 7.1, then 6.7, then 7.4. And in future, we could reach up to 7.8. So this is what the estimation is. Similarly, international financial institutions also estimating that India could reach a level of 7.3%. And RBI is also estimating like 7.4%. So if we are following the current trend of GDP growth, then we could certainly reach this estimated level. Though these all indicates the positive aspect or positive indication of the growth in our Indian economy, though India is recording highest growth rate globally, whether it actually gets reflected in the normal life of the citizens, whether it is helpful in creating the jobs for the normal people, and whether it is helping to reduce the poverty. So that is what the major concern here is. So though Indian economy is a faster growing economy, there are certain concerns that can come in the way of our faster growth, such as the external environment factors, such as trade wars, which is happening around the globe, and reviving of the banking system. There are a lot of NPAs in our banking system. That is also a major concern, and the impact on the fiscal policies in our country. So now we are going to see all these concerns one by one. The first factor is the external environment. So the external environment factors, in the sense the trade wars which is happening between US and China, anyway it is going to affect our country also. Similarly, the country specific sanctions against Iran by the US. So though US putting sanctions on Iran, it is going to indirectly affect our country, because we are a major dependent of crude oil from the Iran. So India's current account deficit is like 0.6% of GDP in 2016-17, but now it rose to 1.9% of GDP only because of the crude oil price rise. So this indicates how external factors could also impact our country's current account deficit and our economy. So understand, right? Similarly, India's trade deficit is also remained high. Like it was before like 4.8%, but now it rose to 6%. So these are all indicating that the external factors like the trade wars, the sanctions of US against the Iran, everything is going to affect our economy directly or indirectly. So what we need to make sure in this case, in the sense how we have to overcome this external environment factors, in the sense, so what is needed now is the rising trade deficit and the some outflow of the capital from our country into the foreign country. These are all negative things. So what we need to do here is, because of this, our currency value is getting depreciated. So RBI now has to come here and intervene and make the management in a better way. And it has to ensure that there is not much fluctuations in our Indian economy. So this is one major thing that we have to do as of now, and make our exports competitive globally and improve the efficiency in the production, as well as the better infrastructure should be provided for both production and employment, everything, and maintenance of domestic stability among the industries. And we have to also opt for alternative fuels like biofuels, which in turn decreases our dependence on the imports of the crude oil or petroleum from the other countries, majorly like Iran. The next major concern is reviving the banking system. So we have to make sure that the banking system in our country gets revived, because there is an increase in the gross non-performing assets in our scheduled commercial banks, which could rose to about 11.6% as of March 2018. In that 11.6%, 15.6% is of public sector banks. So this non-performing assets demotivate the banks to give loans to the industries. So it produces some dampening effect on the provision of newer credits to the industries by the banking sectors. So now the banking sectors are hesitant to give loans or credits to the industries for its revival and all. So what we need to ensure here is the recapitalization of the scheduled commercial banks as well as the public sector banks need to be done first, and the asset reconstruction companies, such as we all know that IBC, which is the insolvency and the bankruptcy code, as well as this FRDI. So everything should be put in place so that to resolve the NPAs in a very faster and effective way. If we do all these things, then we can sustain the higher growth rate of the industrial sector by means of providing newer credits to these industries by banking sectors. So by means of doing these two things, what we are going to ensure here is we are going to ensure there is a sustenance of higher growth rate in the industrial sector by means of stimulating newer credits by the banking sectors to the industries for its growth. So the third major concern is impact on the fiscal policies in our country. So the fiscal deficit as a percentage of total deficit is like 68.7%, which shows that there is a strong improvement in our fiscal policy. But if you go deep into that, there are two major concerns in this fiscal policy. One is the GST revenue. Another one is this newly proposed minimum support price for various agricultural commodities. So though they are good reforms in terms of fiscal policies, what is the major concern here is the GST revenues are currently behind the budgetary projection. What we aimed at the GST revenue is not yet achieved. So it is lagging behind. So this is a major concern. But what the article suggests is it may pick up in the future or in the second half of the current budget year. So similarly, the proposed minimum support price for various agricultural commodities. So this minimum support price is ensured in two ways. One is the MP model, which is the Madhya Pradesh model, in which the state pays the difference between the market price and the MSP. So what it actually ensures is it tells the farmers that you go to the market and you sell the product and you get the money. So the remaining money between the actual market price and the MSP is given by the government. So this is what this MP model. But what if the market price is very low? For example, if market price is 5 rupees and the MSP is 20 rupees, then the difference is very high, right? 15 rupees has to be provided by the government, which is very large. So it is again putting some fiscal burden on the government. So it is a major concern in terms of this model. The second one is government to procure excess production. So if the farmers are producing more than the what actually needed, then the excess production is procured by the government in order to make the market price rise. So this is a better way, which is not putting that much burden on the government. So these two things are the major concerns in terms of fiscal policies defects in our economy. So what we need to ensure here is, though the expected growth rate of our GDP is like 7.3 to 7.4%, though it looks ambitious, or sometime though we may achieve it, what we actually need to ensure here is there should be actual rise in terms of job opportunities for the people, and also there should be actual reduction in terms of poverty. So that should be the priority. So if we actually achieve this in terms of job opportunities as well as reduction of poverty, then only we could have the sustainable development in taking place in our country. So the next article is Indians will live longer if pollution is under check. So recently, international researchers make some policy recommendations to reduce the India's air pollution. So this article is titled like a roadmap towards India's air cleaning. So in that article, what they stated here is around 660 million Indians are not living in a safe environment. They are living actually in a very unsafe environment, which contains fine particulate pollution PM2.5, which is very threat to the human health. So what should be done actually here, they suggested, is the proper monitoring should be done and proper regulation should be done in order to control the air pollution, and making the public more aware about the pollution which is taken place surrounding their environment, and more money should be invested in terms of taking some measures to reduce the air pollution, as well as making use of the markets in the Indian economy to reduce the abatement cost and pollution. So these are all proposed by the international researchers recently. So if India were to achieve this, that means if we actually reduce the air pollution and if we follow the recommendations by the this environment organizations and all, then what could be the positive thing is the life expectancy of the individual would increase by more than 1 year on an average. And if India were to meet this WHO norms, then actually there is an increase of 4 years of life expectancy of the individual. So we should do for this, right? So what the article suggests here is we should be remain optimistic because of the incredible innovations which is taken place in our country, which is being experimented even every now and then throughout the country. So because of that, we are going to achieve a lot in terms of health aspect as well as in the terms of reduction of the pollution. So if it is successful, then there would be a greatest gains for majorly polluted cities like Delhi, Mumbai, etc. So the next article is making lateral entry work. Getting the right leadership talent is always a challenge in both private as well as the public sectors. So recently, government took some initiative to invite the executives from beyond the ranks of the civil service to apply for certain joint secretary posts. So it is a welcome move. So in order to make this very much effective, there are five key elements which we need to make sure that in order to get the success in terms of these kind of initiative. The first one is establish objective criteria. That means what the actual skills or qualities or the experience which is needed from a person who is getting appointed to a particular post. That should be clearly specified in terms of objective criteria. So this is the first major move. So having this objective criteria makes the decision makers very confident in front of the public scrutiny without seeming biased in terms of caste, religion or political affairs, etc. So this is one major thing. The second one is target the talent you need. So you have to find the target what you actually need. The government should not simply sit and wait for the persons to come and approach it. It should proactively go and search for the persons and choose them and appoint them in their respective positions. So the government should not afraid that it is like favoring some candidates or not favoring some candidate. It should not fear. It should proactively go and choose them for their respective appointment positions. So the third one is look for potential to succeed in this environment. So now the environment is set for the lateral entries. Now they have to give them the potential to thrive in that environment. We should make them more engaged in activities. We should give them the adequate opportunities for their development. So the next one is less is more when it comes to selection panels. So if you see in case of interviews which is taken place everywhere, there are like 4 to 5 members in each panel. So it is like shallow interview, it is not in-depth interview. So we should reduce the number of interviewers and we should increase the number of interview rounds as in case of United Kingdom. So this would provide a better opportunity to select a better candidate. So the next one is accelerate the new hires integration. So if they now selected into the respective position, now we have to provide some integrative mechanism in order to motivate them. We have to make sure the difference between their old environment and the new environment, and we have to make them adopt to the new environment. We have to provide some regular coaching for them in order to thrive in this new environment. So this India's lateral entry program is a very good move towards the civil service reforms, but we should make sure that these steps should be taken in order to make it more effective. So the last article is an oxide of arsenic can help fight cancer. So we all know that arsenic is a major contaminant of groundwater reserves. So this arsenic is looking as a poison. Now the researchers are trying to make use of this metal's poisonous nature to treat the infections. So this all-trans retinoic acid, which is in ATRA, is a drug for treating leukemia. So this arsenic trioxide, which is an oxide of arsenic, if when treated these two things together, it will help to reduce the cancer. So this is what the recent researchers suggested. So what they found is when this ATO and ATRA is treated together, it is against the leukemia, which is a type of cancer, because it in turn destroy the PIN1, which is the major stimulator of cancer cells. As we said earlier, that this arsenic oxide is useful for treating the cancer because it destroys this PIN1. So what is this PIN1 in the sense? It is a unique enzyme which is the master regulator of cancer signaling networks. This PIN1 enzyme is activating nearly 40 cancer driving proteins, as well as it inactivates 20 tumor suppressing proteins, which means it is negative. So it activates the cancer cells or increases the cancer cells, it decreases the tumor suppressing proteins. So we need to destroy this PIN1 enzyme from our body, right? So that is why this arsenic oxide is useful for. So they are actually tested, the researchers are tested that if a body, a human body or an animal body is lack of this PIN1 enzyme, then it is highly resistant to developing cancer, which means it is highly resistant to develop cancer in their body even when their cells are overexposed to carcinogenic agents. So what they conclude here is the safe dosages of these arsenic oxide along with ATRA could inhibit or reduce the numerous cancer-driven pathways, as well as it eliminate the cancer stem cells in the cell in our body.